yes, it could. Something's coming, something good. If I can wait, something's coming. Don't know when, but it's soon. Catch the moon, one-handed catch. Yeah.
Everybody and welcome. I'm Brett Musburger. Between them, Louisville and Duke have a combined winning streak of 37 straight games. Since the dawn of the month of February, there has been only one setback suffered by these two teams. That was by Louisville at the hands of North Carolina State. And so, Billy Packer, without question, we have the two finest teams in the land battling for the title.
I would agree, Brandon. If they played 10 games over the course of the year, I think they'd probably be 5-5, but that's not the deal. It's one and done now. And I really believe the word stamina is going to be a key word in this ball game tonight.
Billy, let's go up to the host chair, and here is Jim Nance. Jim?
All right, thank you very much, Britt. We have a completely different scenario than last year in Lexington, when Villanova was a decisive underdog and pulled off the upset, beating Georgetown in an upset that people are still talking about. This is really the first toss-up game we've had in the championship final since 1982, when North Carolina and Georgetown went down to the last seconds at Michael Jordan's winning basket. It's Duke against Louisville for the national championship. It should be another thriller.
For a while Saturday, Coach Denny Crum had reason to be concerned. Led by John Williams, LSU dominated the early going. They led by 8 at the half. But in the second half, the aggressive Cardinals went into their high-flying act, fast-breaking to a 17-1 spurt. And Coach Dale Brown was looking to a higher power to keep Cinderella at the ball. But Louisville, clearly the superior team, wound up breezing to victory. So for the Tigers, the party was over. Coach Mike Krzyzewski's Duke team was expected to be here, largely because of Johnny Dawkins, who shot the eyes out of Kansas in the first half. Ron Kellogg countered with a big effort for the Jayhawks, ending up with 22 points. But otherwise, Kansas coach Larry Brown was having his problems, and they would get worse. Tommy Amaker led a Duke spurt, but the real bad news came when Greg Dreiling fouled out with more than 5 minutes to play. And soon after that, super soft Danny Manning also fouled out. Larry Brown later said he knew then that the lights were going out for Kansas. And they did, when freshman Danny Ferry scored the winning basket in the closing seconds. So now Coach K, the former West Point cadet, takes his top seed of Blue Devils into the championship game. It's Duke versus Louisville.
It'll be the Cardinals of Louisville against the Duke Blue Devils for our national championship. Billy, there are 7 seniors starting tonight, 4 for Duke and 3 for Louisville. One of them is Louisville's talented forward, Billy Thompson, out of Camden, New Jersey.
Great all-around player and is having the tournament of his life. He's really coming on strong in the last part of his stages of his senior career. He can do it all, Brent. He can score, rebound, run, pass, and defend.
He is matched against Mark Allery, who played a spectacular defensive game against Danny Manning of Kansas on Saturday. Allery is a position defender, a scrambler. He'll dive and go after every loose ball.
And in addition to playing the big defensive game, tonight he's also going to have to put some points on the board from the forward spot.
There is a great guard matchup for our fans to watch tonight. The brilliant senior of Louisville, Milt Wagner.
Had an injury last year that kept him out for the year, came back slow at the start of this year. A brilliant shooter from the outside, has the great size, going to be matched up against some quickness, however, tonight.
And Johnny Dawkins, who's averaging 24 a game in the tournament.
He's probably been the outstanding player of the tournament so far. A great penetrator, great outside shooter, the quickest man in college basketball.
And Billy, our keys would be?
Well, the keys in a big game like this, stamina I mentioned at the top of the show. Duke played so hard against Kansas, I don't know if the one day's rest is enough for them. Rebounding, always in a big battle like this, you've got to go on the board. Duke position rebounds. In the case of Louisville, they go up in the air with great leaping. And then the guard matchups. Normally, Louisville, with their great size, handles the guards, but Duke's got a real advantage in quickness.
So we are about to start. Duke and Louisville, and we'll meet the starting lineups in a moment.
Tonight's national championship game is sponsored by Mass Mutual. We insure more than lives, we insure success. Budweiser, peach wood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. And by Today's Chevrolet, who invites you to live the style, performance, and fun of Chevrolet in 86.
Of Dallas, Texas are twinkling tonight as we get ready for the NCAA championship between Duke and Louisville. Inside the Reunion Arena, and let's go to the PA announcer, Frank Fallon, to meet the starting lineups.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Reunion Arena for this evening's national championship game between the University of Louisville Cardinals and the Duke University Blue Devils. Now, let's meet the starting lineups. For Louisville at forward, a 6'7 sophomore from Louisville, Kentucky, number 41, Herbert Crook. For Duke at forward, a 6'5 senior from Drury, North Carolina, number 12, David Henderson. For Louisville at forward, a 6'7 senior from Camden, New Jersey, number 55, Billy Thompson. Duke at forward, a 6'8 senior from Scottsdale, Arizona, number 32, Mark Halloran. For Louisville at center, a 6'9 freshman from Savannah, Georgia, number 43, Purvis Ellison. For Duke at center, a 6'8 senior from Rolling Hills, California, number 21, Jay Billis. For Louisville at guard, a 6'5 senior from Camden, New Jersey, number 20, Milt Wagner. For Duke at guard, a 6-foot junior from Falls Church, Virginia, number 4, Tommy Amaker. For Louisville at guard, a 6'4 senior from Ashland, Kentucky, number 42, Jeff Hall. For Duke at guard, a 6'2 senior from Washington, D.C., number 24, Johnny Dawkins. And introducing the head coaches for Louisville in his 15th season, Denny Crum. For Duke in his 11th season, Mike Krzyzewski.
The Blue Devils have won 21 in a row. The Cardinals, 16. A national title is now at stake. It's been a high-scoring road for the Cardinals in this tournament. Twice they have soared into the 90s, three times into the 80s. As for the Blue Devils of Duke, as they won the East Regional, they have been in the 80s twice and in the 70s three times. The officials tonight, and they are three stories in their own right. Henry Nichols is the referee. This is his sixth NCAA championship game. Don Rutledge was one of the referees in last year's Georgetown Villanova Classic. Peter Pavia of Rochester, New York, beat cancer 2 years ago and has come back now to be one of the officials in this championship game. The Blue Devils and the home whites, because they were the top seed when the tournament began. Louisville was the second seed out of the West region. Controlled by Louisville. Jeff Hall is 42. Knocked away from Crook by Allery.
There's Allery starting right where he left off Saturday. Good position defense, beating Crook to the spot.
Allery had picked up Crook off the tip. Now he is looking into the eyes of Billy Thompson, who throws the inbound pass.
And Duke goes into their tough man-to-man defense.
Crook gets open underneath.
Backdoor move against Henderson, and Henderson giving up about 3 inches there. Here comes the 2-2-1 full court pressure by Louisville.
David Henderson overthrew Jay Billis.
That was a great pass, Brent, with the exception of the height. He looked one way and passed the other and really threw the zone off.
Now, Amaker and Dawkins will return a little bit of that pressure, and how well Louisville can protect the ball could be one of the keys in this game. They get it to Purvis Ellison, and he is smacked by Billis.
We see on that matchup, Louisville also has an advantage in size. Billis again uses his body, but here Ellison is able to go ahead, get the lob pass over the top, go up strong, and Billis comes down on his arm.
Billy, in their first two setups, Louisville has shown great interior motion. They have cut men down towards the glass, and they're showing that athletic skill that they are noted for.
Ellison, regarded by everybody as the best freshman in the country this year, from Savannah, Georgia. I don't think anybody ever anticipated that this fellow would be ready as a freshman with his great court awareness and all that skill. He'll just have to get a little bit stronger to be one of the great players in the college game. Duke fell behind 8-2 against Kansas.
Down the lane that time with Billis, and it's a held ball, but they keep possession. The possession arrow in their direction because Louisville won the opening tap. That will now rotate, and so the next held ball, of course, it will go over to the Cardinals.
Great block by Billy Thompson. He's so quick off his feet.
David Henderson tracks down the loose ball in the corner.
Man-to-man by Louisville. A lot of switching.
Thompson leaning hard on Allery inside, and Henderson hits his first shot.
Now, David Henderson had 6 games in the ACC this year where he scored over 20 points. He is going to have a big score tonight for Duke tonight.
Ellison. Won't get a roll. Allery.
Hall got a piece of that ball, knocked it out of Allery's hand. Both teams, Brent, taking it right at the defense. This game probably going to be more high scoring than I anticipated.
It'll be an up-tempo game all the way. Allery's spot.
That's where he likes to shoot that jumper. He has an excellent jumper from the wings.
Billy, he was not hitting in practice before the start of the game, and he was somewhat frustrated down there. He kept trying it over and over. Ellison misses on the turnaround. Mallory comes off with the rebound. Here's Dawkins.
He'll try to take it in there.
Great penetrating shooter. He shoots on the move as well as anybody I've seen in a long time.
Kind of lulled Wagner to sleep.
Crook is open.
Where's the 45-second shot clock, Brent? We might not have a 4.5-second shot clock the way they're going.
Amaker fouled by Crook, his first.
Now, most people say you can't beat a zone press with a dribble, but in Amaker's case, he's so quick and so low to the ground that he may be able to pull it off.
Billy, there's an early number to watch. One freshman starter, Purvis Ellison. He did not play as well against Kansas as I thought he did in the West Regional down in Houston. He starts off 0-for-2, and we'll see if that starts to bother him.
Good defense by Billy Thompson. Set off that shot by Allery.
Dawkins.
Came off the screen. Nope, Wagner lost him. Wagner and Dawkins went head-to-head against each
other. Wagner lost the ball off his sneaker. Here comes Dawkins.
Oh, was fouled.
Wagner fouled him. So the first big point in that guard matchup that you alluded to at the top of the broadcast, advantage Blue Devils.
There was the quickness by Dawkins. That ball actually went off Milt Wagner's foot, which is not a violation. Wagner tries to go up, but Dawkins, an explosive leaper, is able to get the shot off. And look at the concentration. He stays right with the shot. Brent, I was mentioning, they went head-to-head in the Olympic trials. Neither made the actual team, but Johnny Dawkins was an all-pro.
Denny Crum, the great coach that he is, already went down the bench to young Kevin Walls and made the point. We may see him. He is a pure point guard. I watched him in practice today. He was bringing the ball up. Knocked away from Crook. Here come the Devils again.
Oh, what a change of pace.
Rock
Hawkins, but it's blocked beautifully that time by Thompson, who stayed right with that move.
Willie Thompson, a warrior. He hadn't smiled all night. He wants it all business.
Ellison,
one of three. He just has so much poise for a freshman ball player.
Billy at the other end. Dawkins starts off 3 of 4. Henderson is 1 of 1. Allery 0 of 1. Billis 0 of 1. Amaker has not taken a shot yet.
Ellison way out on Billis.
Allery, a power move, drew the foul. Ellison was moving across the lane with him, but Thompson was there too, and he has assessed the personal foul. Number one on Thompson.
Brent, here's a 1-4 offense where Allery on the high post just beats Billy Thompson because there's no weak side help. Billy Thompson goes up and at least stops the dunk. Could have been a 3-point play opportunity.
So here is Mark Allery at the free throw line, and you talk about a couple of handsome ball players. How about Jay Billis and Allery of Duke? If they don't make it in the NBA, they can always go into the Young and the Restless, I think.
Well, this fellow will play in the NBA, I can assure you. Billis said he cut off his right arm to play in the NBA, except they can't use any one-armed players.
Wagner penetrates. Billis fronting Ellison, denying him the ball as much as possible. Wagner cuts through the lane, was frustrated he didn't get the ball. The Cardinals turn it over.
Great double team. Henderson helping out. Henderson and Aniker able to double team, and Hall came right to Crook, and there was no room for a passing lane. Puts Johnny Dawkins low. It's not often that Wagner sees a guard go low against him.
And then he pops out to the top of the circle.
Brilliant shot. A left-hander going to his right. That's a tough shot to make. Louisville guards haven't had this type of quickness against them.
On the turnover again. Here come the Blue Devils. And then he may have to make a change at that guard spot.
At this pace, Brent, will nobody be able to go the full game at this pace.
Dawkins again coming on through. He is 5 of 6. A total of 11 points. He is outscoring the Louisville backcourt 11-0 here. And Hall changes up.
That ball, a great pure shooter. He's got range even beyond that. The coaches are going to have to go to their benches, Grant. They're playing at too fast a tempo right now. Mark Allery already bending over, holding his pants. And that's what happens when you get tired. You start having some reaching fouls.
And that's the second foul on Herbert Crum. So Denny Crum, who wants to make the first move and send Kevin Rawls, number 15, out of Camden, New Jersey, into the game. Now, this is a key switch in this game. This is critical. He is a pure point guard. He played 8 minutes on Saturday against LSU, and he had 4 assists. Now, because of the 2 fouls, he also must send Mark McSwain, 6'7", out of Atlanta, Georgia, on into the game. And Crook will sit down because of the 2 personals. But the significant change here for this game is Wall. To see how well he can protect the ball. Wagner sits down. Now Billis and Ellison came in behind him, and that is Ellison's first personal.
And there's a case of a body blocking out. Billis has really built himself up over his 4 years at Duke. Extremely strong, uses his body to shield Ellison off. He's able to get the rebound with Ellison coming over the back.
The key part of that replay was the first part. Billis simply shoved Thompson out of the way. You think of Duke as a bunch of nice fellas out there, even sometimes at prep school. Let me tell you, when you talk to the men who play against them, they say they are the strongest, toughest athletes. They clutch and grab. They get hands on you all the time, and they back you in when they low post you all game long. Dawkins trying to run. No basket. Waved off immediately.
There's a screen away from the ball that caused the foul, but I'll tell you, what showed on that play is that there's no way Kevin Walls is going to stay with Johnny Dawkins man-to-man.
We've got a timeout in Dallas. Denny Crum must consider that point. We'll be right back.
Longer have one.
ability. If a youngster is limber enough, he can take a lesson from Johnny Dawkins. I've never seen a release quite like his on his left hand.
Well, he has the ball perfectly set in his hands. You can see how his wrist comes down over. They call that the fish hook move. Johnny Dawkins is not known as a great pure shooter, but I think he is really showing people that he's a better shooter than people expected.
Hey, he's pure enough for me.
I'll tell you another thing about him, Brent. That shot put him at 128 straight games in double figures in his career, an all-time NCAA record, which he is just breaking his own record now, formerly held by Danny Ainge.
Now, Walls brought that ball up with a little more authority than Milt Wagner did. He brought it right up on Tommy Amaker. He got into the set. Here's McSwain. Tries to get it to Ellison.
He thought Ellison was going to go backdoor along the baseline. Again, Duke's man-to-man pressure has given Louisville a lot of trouble. Pointed out at the top of the show, Brent, they're four seniors, so the kids from Duke, they know how to play the game. Been together all their careers.
They were rated the top freshman class in college basketball 4 years ago, and tonight they're playing for a national championship.
Dawkins wanted to post up inside.
Allery is in low, gets McSwain in the air, and hits the slam.
Good positioning by Allery. Here comes Louisville on the break.
And Hall got it right up in the face. He needs a timeout for his injury. He was struck in the mouth. Jeff Hall has a brace on his upper part of his mouth up there, and there was an accidental hand up in the facial area. So immediately, the official Pavia allowed them to have an injury timeout.
See the hand coming up by Henderson. Just happens to catch Hall. Hall did a wise thing by hanging onto that ball with two hands. Could have turned it over.
Allery, as he did against Manning, is tracking Thompson, who comes for the double screen to get daylight.
Billy Thompson to lighten it up in the tournament. A set play by Louisville.
David Henderson comes in. Loose ball. Knocked free. Louisville. Hall out. Here's Walls. Amaker's there.
Smart play. Pull it back out.
He'll wait now. He wants the other guard away, so he's not an effect double team. Bad pass, but it was hit by Billis. So it's legal for Ellison to go into the backcourt.
Dave Billis was so anxious to run down court, he didn't catch that ball. Had an easy breakaway.
Mike Krzyzewski will use his bench, and Milt Wagner will return soon. As Henderson came in, he's assessed the personal foul.
That's great weak side defense by David Henderson. He anticipated the pass coming in the middle and broke all the way across court.
Now there is Danny Ferry, one of the heroes of Saturday, number 35. He will check in, and Billy King, number 55. Is there. Henderson and Billis sit down. King gets a hand on the ball.
That's not backcourt.
Wagner returns it to the attack. Wagner, now the two guard, came up with a shot, and there was contact, and Ferry was making too much of it underneath, so he picks up the person.
Ferry put the body on Ellison on the inside. Of course, his father, Bob, GM in the pros. It looked like Ellison got in a pretty good shot. Ferry comes back at it. Maybe gets caught the second time.
As we expected. Great deal of contact underneath. Swain missing. Thompson rebounding. Trying to come up, and he does. Powerful move by Billy Thompson.
Billy Thompson averaging right off 20 points a game throughout the NCAA tournament. Only averaged 15 during the regular season, but he has been playing the best ball of his career so far in the NCAA.
Duke leading by three.
Ferry's an excellent passer.
They lob it into Allery. And Ellison was there, and that is his second personal foul. A trouble spot for Coach Crum, who yells at Rutledge, the official. He did not agree with that call.
You're going to see a touch. Ellison's going to try to help out here. Good defense. He sees Ferry cutting through. Ferry didn't go through quite quick enough, so Ellison was able to help out, but just a reach touch foul.
Six fouls on Louisville, four on Duke.
Oh, great block.
Comes with it defensively.
Wagner at 6'5", and a good leaper went over Dawkins.
Allery was staying in front of Thompson, trying to deny him the ball as it goes out of bounds on the other side on the turnover.
Right now, I think Louisville's got to get that ball to Billy Thompson. He's the fellow that's been able to score and get inside, and he's not touching it that much.
We will continue to watch that, because we said it about Danny Manning Saturday, and they couldn't get the ball to him because of Allery's great position defense. Amaker comes up shooting for Duke.
Tommy Amaker doesn't shoot much, but the two big field goals really lit Duke up in the game against Kansas.
Billy, following up on that point, Thompson is perfect on the two shots that he's taken so far. Now look at Allery, just stay in front of him down in there. Just denying him the pass, frustrating Billy, pushing him out of his spot, making him come up near the line. Now they get it to him on the bounce.
Good help by Dawkins.
And walls a strip. Amaker comes out on the dribble. It's a 3-on-1 break for Duke. Dawkins.
Great.
And Thompson stays with it, comes out with a rebound, and here's Ellison.
What a great defensive play. 3-on-1 stopped by Thompson.
Turnaround.
That's a 4-point turnaround because of a great play by Billy Thompson. You don't stop Duke on a 3-on-1 break very often.
And again, both coaches will go to their benches at the next stoppage of play. Bounce to Ferry. Wagner reached in and fouled him. Let's take another look at that great defensive play.
This is a clinic. Billy Thompson held his ground inside, didn't foul, and you can see the ability of Johnny Dawkins to stay in the air, and then Thompson pulls down the rebound, heads the break the other way. That's a big-time play.
Now Denny Crum will try a different guard combination. Tony Kimbrough, the 6'7 freshman, number 44, checks in for Coach Crum. And Crum is still working the official over. That's who he was yelling at. He wants some more contact fouls called against Duke underneath. He told me this afternoon at the shoot-around that that was the one thing he was going to stress to these officials. To watch the body fouls by the Duke interior players.
He's not really mad at any specific play. He's just trying to work and get their mindset into that.
And Hank Nichols comes by with a warning. He has now told Coach Crum to take it easy and settle back down.
Danny Ferry on Billy Thompson. He may get a workout here.
They gamble and Crook has it on the turnaround. He had checked in with Kimbrough. Wagner and Kimbrough are the two guards in the backcourt. Now for the Blue Devils with Henderson back. He's out there with Dawkins, King, Billis, and Ferry.
And you notice that Louisville took off the 2-2-1 press and just dropped it back to straight man-to-man. Billy King, really a defender, not a scorer.
Tried to get it to Billis. Stayed right with it. Nice play by Billis.
There's where strength really helped Billis. You can see those arms. He's so powerful.
Now Nichols is warning Crum again. With Allery out, can they now? They push Crook out of the way, and Henderson gets the ball to Dawkins. He has lost it. And
Hill,
Wagner
right.
is coming right back. He hits Thompson. Quick pass to Crook. Crook was slipping, threw up an air ball, and the Devils will come back with it.
Now that's twice that great plays, one by Wagner, one by Thompson, were able to stop Dawkins on the break. You don't stop him two times in a whole ball game, much less in succession.
Dawkins worked the baseline beautifully that time.
They're using a lot of screens down low to get Johnny Dawkins free.
Pass inside to Kimbrough on the turnaround. He was fouled, and the basket counts. Foul by King.
Crook, an excellent role player. Ball goes down inside. Turnaround by Kimbrough. Kimbrough can play either the guard or the forward spot. Crook the same way. They use both players. Then he runs substitutes at will with either player.
Crum studied at the knee of John Wooden, and it was Bob Knight in Indiana who was the mentor of Coach Mike Krzyzewski. He recruited Krzyzewski at West Point. He was in point guard. Earlier today, it was Bob Knight who spoke to the Duke Blue Devils. He went in and reiterated what he had told them on Thursday, to play within themselves, that they had the skill and all the ability in the world to go out tonight and win a national championship. Coach K and Knight are extremely close. They have spent a lot of time together here. Kimbrough gets it to Crook. Three short. Rebound by Duke. And as Henderson came out, he traveled. It'll go over to Louisville.
Again, Duke can't capitalize on that fast break. You think that Bobby Knight's eyes looked like he was up all night diagramming some plays, doesn't it?
They went in the direction of a projector last night after dinner. And you know, Billy Knight lost to Louisville earlier this year. So he does have experience against it. Now, on the other hand, John Wooden has also talked on the phone to Denny Crum this week.
Nice ball movement.
King reached in. He picked up that person.
Of course, Mike Krzyzewski was Bobby Knight's assistant coach in the Pan Am games. United States coming away with the gold medal, and Bobby having some problems in Puerto Rico.
Freshman Kimbrough. He appears to be a big star.
Oh, he will be a big star. Player of the year in Kentucky last year. He's had that strange problem with his arm in two ball games we've seen in the NCAA tournament where he just gets hit kind of like in the funny bone. Everything goes numb on him.
There's nothing wrong with his arm when he threw that elbow in that Kansas game.
Not in those shots either. Billy King picking up that dribble.
Minutes to go, first half. Duke leading Louisville by 5 points.
Great
swing rebound.
Kimbrough did the job, forced it to Henderson, the double play.
Thompson coming through, but the whistle sounded on the release over there.
Foul's going to be on Billy King. It was probably a smart foul because it prevented that layup from counting. It's going to count kicking the ball, maybe. Yeah, he kicked the ball as opposed to the foul. Oh, that saved the basket. Thompson threw that one down with some authority. See, both coaches going to that bench early, Brent. They've got to keep these kids somewhat rested.
McSwain made contact with Billis. And Billis has now picked up 3 personal fouls.
Now that really hurts Coach K for the simple reason he's got to play Ferry a lot more than he would have anticipated early in his first half. He may not realize he has 3. I think he's got to come back with Ferry right away. McSwain out this year with torn ligaments in his knee, coming back to play very well in the NCAA tournament. Was a starter at some last year.
Billis gets the rebound off the missed free throw. Duke gambling with Jay Billis playing with 3 personals at the 8:40 mark of the first half.
Look on Dawkins now.
Switching man to man. Amaker coming up. Gets his own miss.
There's where Wagner's size forced Amaker to alter his shot again. The smallest man on the court right now for Louisville is 6'5", and that's Wagner.
Duke's ball.
Kimbrough at about 6'6½ is a little bit too tall for Amaker to get a passing lane off.
The only one of the Duke starters with more than 1 field goal is Dawkins, and he is 6'9". Everyone else in that starting lineup has only 1 field goal, so he's not getting the scoring balance. Allery has 2 field goals now.
Offensive rebounding that time on the part of Duke. You can't give a team of their caliber 3 shots at it. What the official is saying right now is leave the ball alone after it goes through the basket. Billis, but that could have been dangerous, and Louisville's going right at him trying to pick up that 4th foul here before the half stop.
Dawkins. Louisville, Cook tossing it in the direction of McSwain. It was a dangerous pass to throw in the first place.
Well, Cook didn't realize, I don't believe, that Tommy Amaker was already back there. He thought that McSwain was wide open. I don't believe he would have tossed that ball, but he just didn't see Amaker. And here's Ferry in and Billis out. Good move by Coach Krzyzewski, not wanting to pick up that 4th foul. Duke has been taken out of their offense somewhat here, Brent, in the last two, 3 minutes. They haven't been able to get the smooth working that they had earlier in the half.
Well, one of the reasons why is the constant shuffling of lineups that's been going on by Coach K. It's hard to get into sync when you're not sure who your teammates are going to be.
Chewing on that gum, calm. Looks like he's been to the Final Four 100 times instead of just his first time. Hamaker and Dawkins, 103 straight games they started together in the backcourt, so they ought to know each other's moves.
Jeff Hall is back on the floor for Denny. Has it knocked away from him by Hamaker. Louisville's ball.
Hamaker has quite an advantage on Hall in quickness. He's been able to give Hall a lot of problems.
Duke leading by six at the 7:09 mark of the first half.
Notice Kimbrough now switches up to a forward position.
Galloway with the steal.
Well, he's great on overplay defense at that forward spot. Did it to Danny Manning all day Saturday. There's the lob
to Dawkins, but they could not convert it. And it was last touch by Duke. It'll go over to Louisville. Billy, one of the big differences that is starting to show in this game, Duke's backcourt outscoring Louisville 17-2 right now.
Very hard to get a lob pass over Louisville. And there again, that quickness factor, Amaker on Hall, really a mismatch there. And that lob pass that was thrown to Johnny Dawkins in the last sequence, it usually works against people, but Louisville's quick off the feet. It'll be a hard play to execute.
Crum returns Ellison to his line. On the floor for Louisville, Hall, Kimbrough, and Wagner, along with Thompson and Ellison.
75% free throw shooter.
Really, he's got a little bit of a load to carry next year. He's the only one of the starters coming back for Coach Krzyzewski.
But, you know, you've got Danny Ferry, Billy King, Quinn Snyder, some excellent recruits coming in, so Mike Krzyzewski has stabilized his program. He'll lose a lot of experience and quality players, but I think they'll still be in the hunt.
Which hunt?
I think they'll be in the hunt for a solid ball club, even a top 20 team possibly.
You would have said national championship out of disagreement.
No, well, hey, how about LSU? Where were they a few weeks ago?
Yeah, you're right.
I don't know if I'm right, but it's worth talking about.
The biggest lead of the game. 8 points, 6:40 to go, first half.
Johnny Dawkins again with that quickness, giving Louisville all kinds of problems in the backcourt.
Kimbrough.
There's his versatility. Starts out as the guard, moves down and plays the forward spot.
Billy, Denny keeps telling us he's going to be a guard. I just watch him turn around and slam that one, and I got to believe he's going to be a forward someday.
Well, that's possible. I think he's going to get a lot bigger. He looks like he's going to be a 6'8 man. Beautiful pass.
Missed on the shot, and Ellison yanks it away from Thompson.
Case with Danny Ferry actually got screened out by Tommy Hamaker. He couldn't get over to block out Ellison.
Just like that, they cut that lead in half. Wagner gambling almost came up with a steal. Remember what they did to LSU at the start of the second half on Saturday. Louisville trailed by eight, and bang, bang, they were right there. King on the turnaround, can't get the roll.
Ellison, the MVP of the Metro Tournament, really starting to come to life.
Ferry is fronting Thompson. Hall.
Tough shot.
Fade away. Gallery off the miss.
That's not Hall's shot. He's a standstill jump shooter. He tried to make a play that's not in his repertoire.
And he's one of three as a result of that. And Wagner's struggling here, too. but he struggled in the first half Saturday before he got his wake-up call. Kimbrough blocked that shot by Dawkins. Wagner to the floor. Loose. Louisville down after it. And it's going to be a held ball, and it points in Louisville's direction.
Well, that's what you want to see players do. Kimbrough did exactly the right thing. He went right down on the floor, covered the ball, instead of trying to reach for it. On Saturday against LSU, particularly in the first half, LSU beat Louisville to every loose ball. You see Wagner going to the floor, and then Kimbrough goes right down on the floor. Smart play.
Timeout in Dallas. Rim rattling, roof shattering, slam dunk, and it also turned out that it jarred the 45-second shot clock up on top. And at the other end, Ferry was congratulating Ellison, and they just had someone climb to the top of the basket and adjust that shot clock, get it back in position. You know what I hadn't noticed before until that replay? Little Tommy Amaker was down there at harm's way. Billy.
Well, what he had actually blocked out and screened Ferry perfectly, and Ferry couldn't get to Ellison. Now Hall trying to take Amaker down in low.
Here's Ellison on the run, misfiring. His hands touched it last. It'll go over to the Blue Devils.
He is so smooth. Ellison putting that ball on the floor. Looks like he's frail, but plays tough.
Since the Blue Devils opened up that lead, they haven't scored a field goal in the last 3 minutes. They have missed their last five. Their only points coming at the free throw line.
Johnny Dawkins wisely pulls it out, trying to get his team to some semblance of an offense. Good defense that time by Wagner.
Dawkins.
Good defense by Wagner. Great defense. Double dribble. There's Cook got stuck in the backcourt. Credit Amaker with good defense by staying back in there. You notice how now the size by the guards, Wagner and Hall, and of course they're just getting up there on a defense to the point that Dawkins and Amaker aren't able to get their jump shots off.
Well, Dawkins has missed his last four. He's been carrying the load offensively. Henderson has stopped and comes back off of the miss. That's Henderson's second field goal. He is 2 for 5. Allery is 2 for 5. Dawkins is 6 of 12. Thompson is 2 of 2. Both of them coming very early in the game, so he's taking a break right now. And
watch the ball when he's in there.
Wagner and Allery drop it, and Ellison cleaned it up.
I think the Duke team is getting a little tired right now, Brent. You can notice that Louisville's getting a lot better shots on the inside. Look for a run right now by Louisville.
They're also getting rebounds.
Yep.
Wagner and Amaker foul him.
Now Duke has gone hard. Johnny Dawkins has not been out of the game. Neither has Tommy Amaker. If anything, has Amaker been out for a second or two? But I know Dawkins has not been out. And I think they're starting to get a little tired.
Here, the guard matchup. We mentioned this is one of the keys. And Duke outscoring Louisville 19-2. But Dawkins gathered most of his points very early.
Great free throw shooter, shooting 85% on the year, but over 90% during the NCAA tournament, and about 95% in the last 4 minutes during the NCAA tournament.
Kimbrough leaving, and you saw Thompson returning to the lineup.
Very valuable minutes by Kimbrough. I think defensively, what Duke has been able to do to Wagner is pushing out farther from the court with their great quickness. That's probably why he's not been able to get his jumper off very much. But right now, I think the momentum is swinging Louisville's way. He said fatigue would be a factor, and it looks like it's setting in here right before the first half ends.
Knocked loose, and it goes over. Touch last by Duke. So Louisville on an 8-2 run over the last 3.5 minutes for Coach Dinicum. And they have cut an 8-point lead down to 2. 33-31. The Cardinals can tie with this possession.
Look for Billy Thompson. Back where he goes, and they throw it away. Good job by Henderson coming over to help out. I think right now, Brent, Duke has got to be thinking about clearing out for Johnny Dawkins to try to get him the shot. Milt Wagner really shielding him all the way down the court.
out for Dawkins. Good help by Hall.
Jumps in, and it's stolen by Ellison, the center. Duke regains the lead.
Set play. Duke did try to clear out for Dawkins, but Louisville playing some outstanding man-to-man defense now of their own, and Ellison coming alive.
Knocked away by Henderson. Here's Amaker.
Oh, Henderson kept it alive.
Foul underneath.
Duke has not been able to capitalize on the fast break opportunities. That's three times tonight. But they had an easy fast break and couldn't capitalize.
Billy, look at Coach Crum. Don't I remember the 1980 videotape that I have looked at where he won his only national championship? Didn't he have a red carnation in the lapel of that coat? Do you remember that? I've seen that so often. He's on the bench. Darryl Griffith has the big night. And the assistants all showed up with those red carnations. Well, you know, Coach, I'm talking about your carnation. Why don't you turn around?
For me to remember that, like asking, was it Wally Brown's left thumb or right thumb that didn't go with him to the game?
I listened to you that night. I was rolling on the floor. There it is.
I know one thing. If it is his carnation, he's taking good care of it. Kind of like that trophy he won that night. Looks like Denny Crum's going to ask him to press right here. Can't press when you don't hit the free throws. Billy Thompson had a streak at the start of the tournament, 14 for 14 from the foul line.
Perry gets it to Henderson. That last by McSwain.
You notice that you just can't lob the ball over the top of Louisville unless you have a monster. Chris Washburn of NC State, the last team to beat this Louisville club, is able to pull it off at 6'11", but you don't do it otherwise.
Ellison coming away with the rebound, and he is fouled by Henderson, his third personal. Well, at the conclusion of tonight's NCAA championship game, we will select a Chevrolet most valuable player from each team. Chevrolet will donate a $1,000 scholarship to the general scholarship fund of both Duke and Louisville. Speaking of scholarship, a point I want to make about these Duke seniors. There are four who will start, one over there on the bench, Weldon Williams. Henderson is one of them. They are all going to graduate on time. They all went to summer school, made up some missing credits, and all will graduate with their class. And Coach Krzyzewski saying that's the way he wants to run his program.
Curtis Ellison shooting under 60% from the foul line. Weldon Williams in the game. Billy Thompson on him.
Perry ships inside to Williams.
Curtis Ellison altered the shot.
Walk, swing, traveled. Got away with it. Allery with those quick hands. Batted the ball away with from McSwain.
One shot now for Duke. Mike Krzyzewski gives the signal. Amaker will go for try to get Dawkins free or Allery free for the last shot. Notice they have nobody playing in the pivot position. Have everybody up high. Milt Wagner knows what to expect. He doesn't want Dawkins to handle this ball. Trying to clear out for Amaker. Beautiful execution.
Duke hits only four of their last 15 shots, but they make the most of them for Coach K. Denny Crum and the Louisville Cardinals head for their locker room, down by three. On Saturday afternoon against LSU, they were down by eight. Duke leading Louisville 37-34, and the Blue Devils are one half away from their first championship in any team sport. Let's go up the gymnast, Jim.
Thank you very much, Fred. You know, in that first half, Louisville only trailing by three, but their star player, Milt Wagner, did not even hit a shot from the floor. What a job Tommy Amaker did on him with four steals. But a big first half for Johnny Dawkins, and the Blue Devils lead right now at intermission. And CBS Sports coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship will continue after this message and a word from your local stations.
Tonight's national championship game is sponsored by Mercedes-Benz, engineered like no other car in the world.
And we're enjoying pictures tonight of Dallas from the blimp provided by Goodyear, whose captain is Don McDuff, the Goodyear Blimp America out of Houston, Texas. For Dallas, this has been the biggest basketball weekend in its history. And the hosts of the Final Four have given the players and their fans a Texas-sized welcome.
Hello, Texas. Sure good to see you again. Hello, Texas. Sure good to see me a friend. Hello, Texas. Sure is good to see you again. Hello, Texas.
We want to welcome you all to Dallas for the Final Four.
A fun time down here. Right, Ernie? Yeah.
Enjoy the Final Four.
And some of the sights and sounds this week at the Final Four in Dallas. By the way, next year's tournament will be in New Orleans, a city that also knows how to show its visitors a good time. We're at halftime here in Dallas. Duke in front by three. We'll continue in just a moment. Behind Johnny Dawkins, 15 points. Duke leads Louisville 37-34 at intermission. We are just 20 minutes away from the end of another long season. And with that in mind, Brent Musburger has some thoughts on the state of the game. Here now with some highs and lows of college basketball.
Throughout the tournament, we have focused on the joy and the spectacle of the games themselves. But there is a dark side to the story of college athletics, widespread abuses that threaten to undermine the very game itself. Now, that sad litany includes unethical recruiting practices, under-the-table payment to athletes, and perhaps saddest of all, a disregard for academic integrity that strikes at the very heart of a university education. Now, for the last 18 days, we have seen much of the best of what college basketball represents. First, the quality and parity of the competition. No other sport provides as many dramatic endings. Game after game comes down to those final hectic seconds, the buzzer beater. No other big-time sport is as democratic. Time and again, we've seen small and unheralded schools challenge and even defeat the biggest and best programs in the land. Indeed, although Duke is playing for the national championship tonight, the Blue Devils had more than a few anxious moments in their first-round game against Mississippi Valley State. Then there's the intense loyalty of the students, which gives them a powerful sense of allegiance that they'll maintain all their lives. And finally, we witnessed the unselfish stardom of Navy's David Robinson, who chose to forego the wealth and glamour of a pro career because of obligations to his team and country. Robinson, an excellent student, too, represents the ideal. So the goal of being a legitimate student athlete is not impossible. Now, there are encouraging signs. Stiffer penalties are being handed out for recruiting and academic violations. That's a step in the right direction. But in the end, the burden is on the universities themselves, from the president, through the booster groups, through the athletic directors, through the coaches, and yes, each individual athlete, to clean up their own programs before it's too late.
Duke leading Louisville, 37-34. Billy, let's go back and take a look at some of those keys that you pointed out at the top of the broadcast.
Well, Brent, we thought that that backcourt duo of Duke was going to go ahead and have their hands full or possibly give Louisville a lot of trouble. And look at what happened. Duke 21-4 in backcourt scoring. Just amazing that Duke would dominate to that degree. Now rebounding. Both of these teams have been out-rebounding their opponents by over six a game. It's a Mexican standoff so far. Duke's Bulls inside against Louisville's jumpers. And then the shooting comparison. Here are those key matchups. Thompson and Wagner not doing anywhere near as well as Allery and Dawkins. 19 shots as opposed to six.
So one half still to go, the battle for the national championship. And we will continue live after this message and a word from your local station.
Tonight's national championship game is sponsored by Hewlett-Packard, the people who turn your business computing problem into a business computing solution. Mazda cars and trucks, the more you look, the more you like Mazda value. And by Atra from Gillette, the essence of shaving.
To start the second half in this NCAA championship game, it will be Duke's possession against Louisville. They lead by three. And Billy, what about the contribution of Purvis Ellison late in that first half for Denny Crum?
Well, he really came on strong. One of the things that's allowing that to happen is that Duke is pushing the Louisville guards out so far, there's no room to help on Ellison, so he's getting the lob.
Mallory bangs the first shot down.
So much easier to shoot when you have a little rest. Billis with three fouls has to be careful here early in the second half. Louisville looks like they want to keep going to Ellison.
Mallory right there with Thompson, just as he was with Manning on Saturday afternoon. Thompson gets in behind him that time.
And again, Brent, when you put so much pressure outside on the shooting perimeter players of Louisville, you don't have the help on the inside. Louisville's very good at going over the top of those passes.
Henderson.
Good double pump. Got little Thompson in the air. Thompson's ball handling ability. Excellent.
Ellison stick with it.
So quick off the floor. He was able to get back up on his second leap faster than the Duke players could come down from their first one. Mallory was looking for his jump shot.
Mallory was cut off from going down the baseline by Crook, so he wisely came back out. Dawkins.
Short.
Crook rebounded.
Last time they hollered at Johnny Dawkins for an air ball was in the Kansas game when he missed the foul. There they are again. Over the top.
And low.
Dawkins will answer that air ball cry. But again, Louisville able to go right over the top of Duke's defense.
Was a push-off offense that would go over to Louisville.
Mallory knew it. Seems like the game has gotten down to slow motion compared to the way it started. You see Mallory, they swing the ball, and he's going to push off on Ellison. Gets caught by the official, no question about the foul.
And that was one of Coach Crum's complaints in the early going of this basketball game. Remember then when Billy Packer said he's just delivering a message for the later going of these stages.
Again, looking inside. There's another one.
Crook.
Now, Mike Krzyzewski can't let this momentum go, and he's going to call the timeout quickly.
Louisville's last lead in this game was an 18-10 of the first half.
Crusher Smith will slug it out, plus World Figure Skating Exhibitions and John Madden's Journeys next weekend on CBS Sports Saturday.
Billy, we have seen these bursts by Louisville all along this season.
Now watch Ellison, up once, up twice, up three times to get that offensive rebound.
Dawkins off the penetration.
Oh, great
threw
shot.
The foul on Milt Wagner.
Milt was right with him. had his hands in the air, but Dawkins, again, with that super quickness. Hill just shaking his head.
Of the variety of defenders Crum used against Dawkins, I felt that Wagner was the least successful in the early stages of this game. He may have to make another adjustment here soon if Dawkins starts to light up the scoreboard.
Dawkins picking up farther out now. Duke trying to extend their defense, maybe to make some of those passes more difficult to throw. A lot more pressure.
5-second violation. Dawkins forced the turnover. And immediately, Crum will bring in Kevin Walls as his point guard. Now, he told me this afternoon an interesting thing about Wagner and Thompson. He said, you can jump all over Milt Wagner. You can get on him, you can ride him, you can tell him when he's wrong, as he'll do now, and Wagner will respond for you. He says, Thompson's a more sensitive young man, and you have to be very careful how you deal with him in those situations. Dawkins took a running shot.
What did I say about that air ball, champ? He touches it twice since then, scores both times.
Walls. Missing the shot, winds up in the hands of Jeff Hall.
Ellison getting ready to post up inside.
It's away from Thompson, and it was out of bounds.
Now, what has happened to Louisville now? They've lost some of their momentum. Just when it looked like they were going to make the spurt.
And basically, the difficulty is back there at that point guard spot. What do they say? You got to have the big man, but you also must have that point guard to win a national championship. Dawkins
foul.
On the run has drawn another one.
Dawkins sensed early. Remember in the first half when there was a foul inside for pushing, but Dawkins blew right back by Kevin Walls? You know, he's got that judge now, and he's going to take Walls. He's just going to go right by him. Just too quick. People felt that Johnny Dawkins could be the difference between these two clubs, and he's shown it so far tonight.
Jumping into Allery. Billy from behind, got a hand on it. Here's Walls.
Again, Louisville's got to get back to that inside game. There it goes.
And quick foul underneath by Allery. That's two on Mark Allery.
Kimbrough back in. Kimbrough had an excellent first half. I think Denny Crum just going to try to keep fresh people on Johnny Dawkins. Got to wear him down a little bit.
Well, Kimbrough gives them a lot more size than Walls does in this matchup. Walls is 6'1", and Kimbrough is 6'7".
Herbert Crook averaging 14 a game throughout the tournament. Been a pleasant surprise for Louisville. Nobody anticipated to be a starter this year.
Kansas coach Larry Brown enjoying a little ice cream over there with the members of his Kansas Jayhawk coaching staff. He lost a tough one, and he said all along, we're here to stay and see the championship game even if we don't play in it. Amaker saved it and got it into the hands of Allery. Crum thought the ball was out of bounds.
I don't think Denny realized that official was right down on the end line, had a perfect view of that one.
Dawkins gets inside, and Kimbrough fouled it.
Johnny Dawkins putting on a show right now. Mackin High School product. Home of Austin Carr, the man who still holds the record for individual scoring in a game in the NCAA tournament.
It's really kind of a national team out there for Duke when you think about it. Allery's out of Scottsdale, Arizona. He'll inbound the pass. Billis, Rolling Hills, California. Henderson, he's local product out of North Carolina. Amaker, he's out of Virginia. Dawkins out of Washington, D.C.
Denny Crum probably scratching his head trying to think, who in the world can I get in here to defend against him?
Kimbrough on a nice turnaround, going to the glass.
One of the best ways to defend against him is to make him work on defense, and that's what Kimbrough will do. Now, Kimbrough's talking to Johnny Dawkins. Not too smart for a freshman.
Allery fouled by Ellison. That's three personals on the freshman, and Denny Crum again. He's happy with the call.
He's working those officials. Denny Crum works him kind of like John Wooden did. Very quiet, gentle.
Oh, yeah, but there was a great big difference. John Wooden would sit over there with that program in his hand.
Well, Benny's got one wrapped up.
Yeah, but he would sit there. He never knew he was talking to him.
Steps on Henderson. And Benny's still wondering what that foul was all about. up there with three is Ellison.
Brooke.
It's amazing how they can throw that long pass right over the defense. Mike Krzyzewski going to come in with Danny Ferry, trying to get a little more size.
Dawkins has scored Duke's last 7 points. Here he is again trying to create. Gives it up to Allery. Henderson will take it.
That's Ellison. A foul. Allery
from behind. His third.
Now, Brent, it really hurts if you're a Duke fan to see Henderson miss that wide open jump shot. That's one you ought to bury. Instead, if you miss the easy shot, Allery picks up a tough foul. Now, Duke's starting to be depleted a little bit with that foul problem. Berry's in, going to take Billy Thompson.
Louisville can tie it. Cook is free. Didn't have control.
That's a kick.
Goes back into the hands of Jeff Hall. Kimbrough. Another offensive rebound by the Cardinals. They're starting to gain an advantage off the glass.
Well, it's going to be a foul, I believe, of Billy Thompson reaching in.
It's his second.
Thompson walked by Dawkins. They both tapped each other. A lot of mutual respect out there. Two All-American ball players. Johnny, of course, the Naismith Award winner. Consensus All-American this year.
Amaker up a good move. He did that on Saturday afternoon. He put together a couple of big scores against Kansas. He just needed it. Back to a 4-point, and Thompson reduces it to two.
Billy Thompson on that jump shot just goes and uses that chest to keep the defender off, puts that ball way behind his head. Very difficult to block.
Henderson coming down the baseline. He is fouled by Thompson. That's Thompson's third.
Thompson kind of tripped that time over Crook. He didn't realize that Henderson had that kind of quickness. Denny Crump really rotating those guards, trying to get a fresh man on Dawkins at all times. There's something about the stamina of Johnny Dawkins. He has run the mile as low as 4:38, Brent. He can go out anytime he wants to and run under a five-minute mile. He's got incredible stamina. Usually, you know, a couple of years ago, he'd play 40 minutes every ball game. Just an iron man.
Coach K's wife, Mickey Krzyzewski, living every moment with her husband here this afternoon. Mike's mother is also in the audience. She's an elderly woman out of Chicago, and he said, hey, my mom is really getting into this. She loves it down here. She shows up with a suntan and gold jewelry for the championship game. I'll know I've created a monster.
Now Duke goes into his zone for the first time tonight. Trying to stay out of foul trouble, maybe rest Dawkins a little bit. 2-3 zone by Duke.
Remember, Wagner looking for his first field goal, 0-for-3. Dawkins on the turnover, lead to Amaker, who is cut off and brings it back, but that's his second dribble.
Well, Mike Krzyzewski said, tough break, he should have just picked it up. He looked at Tommy Amaker, kind of made eye contact there, and he realized it. Watch Dawkins' anticipation. Goes straight up in the air, picks it off with two hands. Gives it up to Tommy Amaker, and Amaker wasn't able to split the seam.
Hall checks in, and Crook leaves. Kimbrough moving up front with Thompson and Ellison.
Now, Hall was back in there anticipating that Duke would stay in the zone. He's a zone buster from the outside, but Duke goes back to man-to-man.
King is taking Kimbrough.
Amaker on the reach.
His second. Allery to return for the Blue Devils.
I think Kimbrough has really played some outstanding minutes off the bench, although he hasn't put a lot of points on the board, playing solid defense and very positive offensively. Ellison hasn't touched it in a while since Ferry has been in there. Brent Ferry really putting the body on him.
Wagner still can't get his first field goal.
That's Thompson. Billy Thompson.
Reached and pushed off.
That's his fourth. That's a tough break for Louisville. He has been there for a number of minutes here.
Thompson leaves at the 12:30 mark with the Cardinals trailing by four. Herbert Crook back in the game.
And a real story on the foul line. Billy King has not been able to hit the foul shots at all, only shooting 47% on the year. It's been a real problem for him.
Hasn't solved it.
But a big break for Duke. You really have to worry about blocking out when he goes the line because, you know, 50% of the time he's not going to hit it.
And now on Wagner, that's his fourth person.
Well, what brought Duke to this game is drawing foul trouble on their opponent. Kansas got in serious foul trouble, losing both Dreiling and Manning on Saturday. And there was the reach by Wagner. Mallory got the short pause. Ought to be rested.
McSwain checking back in for Coach Crum.
Wagner having to go out, and here Kimbrough then shifts back to the guard spot. This is probably the weakest ball handling backcourt that Louisville could have in the game at any one time. Look for Duke to pick up full court pressure as you've got Hall and Kimbrough back there at the guards.
Championship game between Louisville and Duke.
Amaker realizing goes right out on Hall. Now Duke goes back to the zone. 2-3. They showed him the man-to-man, then they went back to the zone. Denny Crump would love to have Wagner in the game now because when he has Wagner and Hall out there, they love to shoot over that zone.
And throws a little flat with the shot. McSwain takes it away from Farrell. Hall, the top of the circle.
Great shooter. He will be the one man against that zone that you really have to protect on the perimeter.
Blocked by Kimbrough. In a foot race, off Hall, run down by Dawkins.
Well, you can't teach quickness. And there was Amaker and Dawkins. Just so quick. Kimbrough again showing some problems for Amaker because even when Amaker penetrates, Kimbrough is so tall he can stop him.
Mallory. Well, a couple of storylines are really developing. The Duke guards have badly outplayed their Louisville counterparts, and Billy Thompson's foul problems gives a distinct advantage to Mark Mallory offensively now because he doesn't have to hound Thompson at the other end on defense. Regains the touch, the control.
He has a good catch that time by Kimbrough, thrown right at his ankles.
Swain. Dawkins will come out. Allery.
At the stroke going, probably not a wise shot there, Brent. Nobody out there to rebound on the weak side.
Kevin Walls is up a little bit.
That's how Louisville's going to try to break fellas right across the middle on Danny Ferry to get the ball. There comes Crook.
Ellison. Turnaround. Duel personal from Ferry, and that's his second. Phyllis and Henderson return for Coach Krzyzewski's lineup. King and Ferry leave. For Louisville, Kimbrough is out and Walls is in.
It's an excellent shot by Purvis Ellison. He turns and goes right up on Ferry. Ferry pushes him. Ellison still has that good touch and hits the shot. Abilis has three, so Mike Krzyzewski's been able to get halfway through this second half without any further foul problems, and Duke's got a big advantage there.
Ellison with 16 points, now 17, to go with his 8 rebounds and his 2 blocked shots. The freshman having a big night here in the NCAA championship game.
Brent, also the respect for the Duke guards, Denny Crum not using the 2-2-1 full court press because Dawkins and Amaker handled it so well.
Amaker short. Cook rebound. Louisville can edge to within one, and that was Amaker reaching in his third foul.
And even though they were in the zone, they kind of sensed that Hall's ball handling was a little shaky and went right after it.
Timeout here in Dallas at the 9:47 mark. We'll be right back.
Two veterans, leading scorers, Wagner and Thompson, both with four. And Brent, we never would have believed that there would be that type of differential in the backcourt.
Kevin Wall's in that backcourt right now.
He goes man to man.
Swain. It's a 1-point game.
And considering Wagner and Thompson are on the bench, you can see how outstanding this Louisville bench has been and how deep it's been throughout the course of the year. And Louisville goes to his zone. You don't see this often from Denny Crum.
Dawkins going in low, and Henderson couldn't get it to fall. And the Cardinals can take the lead.
Super job by Ellison on the inside.
Hands off inside.
Ellison had Phyllis.
Goes over to Duke.
That's a matter of judgment in feeding the post, and Denny Crum saying he was wide open earlier.
Louisville staying in the game by climbing all over Duke on the glass, down by a point, even though they've got foul trouble.
Now they're playing Johnny Dawkins one man. They're playing a matchup zone with four men and Dawkins man to man. Amaker does the right thing. He sneaks down in the corner. There's a little diamond and one on Johnny Dawkins, trying to cut him off.
Knocked free by Amaker. He comes up with it. And he's fouled by Walls.
Best thing Kevin Walls could do. And again, the Duke guards just pickpocket everything that's going on. Seven steals for Tommy Amaker. .575 assists on his career, Brent. Just been outstanding. 6.2 a game. He only turns the ball over 2.4 times a game. And on the years, had 14 games where he's turned it over one or less times.
Milt Wagner will come back in with those four personals, and Walls will leave. Wagner, in his final game as a collegian, is 0 for 4. But remember, he is lethal the last 5 minutes, nicknamed Ice by his teammates.
One thing will be interesting for Denny Crum here. Who does he put on Johnny Dawkins if he stays in the box and one? If it turns out to be Wagner, Dawkins will probably try to take him. Get that fifth foul on him, because you don't want him in there at the end of the ball game with his great free throw shooting ability.
Situation. Ferry quickly replaces Allery.
There's Allery reaching in. The tough pass to sneak inside. Ferry in. Duke may have to play even more zone now. Oh, Ellison is so outstanding with that leaping ability. Crum working over that soda, isn't he?
Yeah.
But they're all playing man-to-man.
Not free, but picked up underneath by Henderson.
They gave the look of the boxing one, but they're all playing man-to-man. That's kind of like Danny Ferry picking up that loose ball against Kansas.
Ellison.
Spreading out the guards, it's so easy to get that lob because there's nobody back there to help out. Duke wanted to use the clock here. Mike Krzyzewski says pull it back out. Johnny Dawkins out just as they did at the end of the first half.
Henderson misses. Louisville. And as Cook came down, he traveled. It goes to the Blue Devils on the turnover.
Brent, with this much time on the clock, I'm surprised that Duke pulled it out there. It's very difficult as the clock works down with, say, 6-8 seconds to go to get off the good shot against a team like Louisville that can leap so well.
And Billy, do you think that's a mistake pulling it out?
Yes, I really do. I think it takes away your momentum. And it really caused you to have to take some real tough shots.
Duke is leading by 4. 61-57.
Good help by Crook.
Now they have the NBA shot clock to work with.
Wanting the goaltending, but he caught it on the way up.
Wagner. Blocking foul.
Basket should count.
Basket counts.
Amaker left. No, Wagner get all the way around him on that baseline. Now, when you really look at that play over again, Brent, Wagner made contact on the way up, but he was in the shooting motion, so the basket counts.
That's the fourth personal on Billis. Allery with 4 has returned, and Ferry sits back down.
Then I go back to that business of delaying the game a little bit. It really hurts your mo.
A one-point game on the free throw by Wagner.
Jeff Hall. Dangerous pass from that far away.
Fouled by Ellison. His 4th.
Now, Louisville does a lot of switching in their man-to-man. That time, Ellison just got caught on a switch with Henderson, who's a lot quicker from that position. Actually, 3 players on the floor right now with 4 for Louisville. Thompson, Purvis Ellison, and Milt Wagner.
And 2 for Duke. Allery and Billis. At the 5-minute mark.
Henderson gets all of the roll.
There are some players seated on that bench who have been enjoying the action, who may wind up in the biggest game of their lives here before this one's over. There's a long time to have 5 players with 4 personal fouls out there.
Here's Johnny Dawkins, who has not been on that bench for 1 second, still playing tough D.
Roy.
That was Henderson who made the block of that pass. Herbert Crook kind of looked it away. You can't telegraph that defender.
A
a better shot because Allery likes that jumper from that distance.
Denny Crum calls a timeout at the 4:13 mark. We'll be right back. So along with Billy Packer, I'm Brett Musburger. 4:13 to go. Both Denny Crum and Mike Krzyzewski with three timeouts apiece.
Good position to be in, Brent, with the timeout situation. The arrow is pointing right to Louisville's favor, so that can help in a jump ball or held ball situation. Foul problems. Both teams have a serious problem. They lose any one of those players.
And all five are on the floor at the 4:13 mark. Alloy with a hand on it, knocked it out of bounds. Thought he had it off of Thompson. Ellison, it's a one-point game.
There's that two-man game on that high post for Louisville. They execute that play so well.
He collided with Cook. Offensive foul. That's his fourth.
Smart play by Cook, Brent. Just to hold his ground, not reach with his hands at all. He played him with his chest.
Now there are six with four. Bill can go ahead this trip.
Lob.
Wagner. Danger. Johnny Dawkins has been held scoreless the last 11 minutes. Only one shot he has squeezed off in that time. Foul by Hall. His second.
What's interesting, Brent, both of these clubs work a system offensively, and when teams get down to pressure points, you see how well they revert back to the system. Denny Crum coming out of that UCLA system, high-low post. They're just executing perfectly. Duke better get this ball in a hurry.
This was the last drill that both of these teams practiced today. The coach is yelling, all right, both ends, shoot some one and ones.
Oh, yeah, early.
And Dawkins gives Duke the lead, 65-64.
Thank you.
7 mark. And Billy, what about Johnny Dawkins from the field?
Well, surprisingly, he has his last field goal came at the 13-minute mark. We're down to 147. And the man that really turns out to have the best matchup on Johnny Dawkins has been Hall, the man that you at least expect to be able to stay with him because of quickness.
Well, Duke has done it at the free throw line lately. They are 19 of 21 tonight. They have no field goal since 7:15, so that's 5 minutes and 18 seconds. 6 players going down the stretch. 4 fouls apiece. A possession arrow pointing in the direction of Louisville in any hell ball situation. Louisville up by a point.
Duke trying to set a double screen for Johnny Dawkins to try to get Paul away from him.
Henderson missing. Dawkins comes out. He still hasn't had that field goal.
Louisville running their spread offense, so look for backdoor cuts.
Seconds. That does not give Denny and the Cardinals much time when we come back from that timeout. We'll return. We're back with 48 seconds. Denny Crum and Louisville leading Mike Krzyzewski and Duke by a point, 66-65. Billy, who would you like to see handling the ball if you were Coach Crum right now?
Well, you want the ball in Bill Wagner's hands, even though he has 4 fouls. Now, the key thing here is to get the ball in bounds. The man on the sidelines is Billy Thompson. Cannot move, even though he's out of bounds, but one pivot foot. Now, remember, we had the big play with Danny Manning in the game on Saturday where he actually walked in the sidelines. But you better believe they'd like to get Milt Wagner the ball here.
They must hurry. Ball takes the shot and misfired, but Ellison was there. The biggest rebound of this championship game.
Referee stopped the clock. That was a shot that came up short.
Henderson. And Ellison fouled. And Louisville realizes that they're in command. Celebration goes on. Suddenly, the waning moments become somewhat desperate for Duke. They have lost Mark Allery. That was his 5th personal. 27 seconds to go. Louisville is up by 3. And the young man who did it with a rebound and a field goal out of Savannah, Georgia. Irvis Ellison, 23 points, 11 rebounds. It is a freshman who has led the way here tonight.
Ray's only a 57% free throw shooter, but not in the clutch. Louisville has to be careful. Do not foul.
That ties Ellison's career high. 25 points. Amaker quickly. Billis gets it in.
Mike Krzyzewski saying he got fouled on that play. Wants the 3 corner, but he doesn't get it.
Billy, I'm going to take you back to those moments when Coach K pulled the ball out. And you said at the time that that was a mistake. I dare say he may be regretting that move right now.
Well, it took away a lot of momentum, and it took Johnny Dawkins out of the game. Up until that point, he'd been able to penetrate with the ball. And from that point on, he hadn't been able to score.
the possession arrow right now. The Cardinals of Louisville. They have a three-point lead. 18 seconds to play. And who should Duke put on the free throw line? Well, certainly not Milt Wagner.
That's for sure. Or Billy Thompson or Hall. All three of those are great free throw shooters. Curtis Ellison's the guy you want on the line, but he's having a good stroke right now. Billy King coming in, a little bigger defender. And a little quicker.
You get it to Cook and right back to Thompson, who's fouled by Henderson. And Henderson has fouled out of the game. He joins Allery on the sideline.
Billy Thompson on the year, a 72% free throw shooter, but as I said, in this NCAA tournament, every one of his stats are a lot higher. His field goal shooting percentage is up to 60, above 55, and his scoring is almost 20 points a game.
One of the things they can never take away from those Duke youngsters is the fact that they have already won 37 games this year. More than any team in the history of college basketball. This would be their only third loss of the year. They lost two ACC games back to back. North Carolina and Georgia Tech both on the road. Thompson misses. Billis is off.
You got to take it to the basket here. Hope for a three-point play.
Amaker to the glass. Loose. The battle goes to three. And it's a one-point game.
Good hustle by Danny Ferry. Kept that ball alive. Louisville couldn't get it.
3 seconds and a one-point lead.
Brent, all you can do is foul immediately on the inbounds pass. You cannot allow, obviously, the ball to come in and let a man hold it. You've got to foul as soon as it's thrown inbounds. Try to go for the steal immediately. Commit the foul. And I believe if you're Louisville, you want to get the ball thrown in at least up to half court. Now, you remember the Georgetown-Villanova game last year. That inbounds pass, there was only 1 or 2 seconds at that point, but remember that inbounds pass was thrown and we almost had a big turnover there. You want to get that pass inbounds, you'd like to get it up around half court so Duke can't get an easy putback.
Point lead by Louisville, 70-69 with 3 seconds to go. And again, Billy Thompson takes it out of bounds for the Cardinals. Dawkins immediately.
Two shot. Nope, they call it 1-1.
Wagner is perfect on 3 free throw attempts here this evening.
Duke did the only thing they could there, Brent. They tried to go ahead and stop that clock immediately. Now, Duke is also at this time setting up what they're going to do in case Milt Wagner misses this shot. Look at that free throw percentage in the final 4 minutes.
He struggled all game long. He came down the stretch with 4 fouls. He kept himself in the game. Now the man they call Ice will try to show that he can live up to that nickname. It's a free throw for the national championship. Louisville will win it. The Cardinals have won the national championship. Denny Crum does it again. 4 times in the last 7 years to the Final Four. And he beats Mike Krzyzewski in a great final. Thank you. So at the start of this game, we compared this contest, a toss-up, to the 1982 Classic between Georgetown and North Carolina. And now another comparison can be made. It was in 82 at New Orleans. In a losing cause, the Patrick Ewing era began in college basketball as Ewing had a big night. Tonight in Dallas, in a winning effort, it was Purvis Ellison establishing the Ellison era in college basketball. Only a freshman, 25 points and 11 rebounds. We'll come back in just a moment and hear from the winning Louisville Cardinals, the national champion, in just a moment. So the Louisville Cardinals are the national champions. The Chevy MVPs tonight, Purvis Ellison, the freshman, 25 points and 11 rebounds. And the great one, Johnny Dawkins, finishing his career at Duke with a 24-point effort tonight. Let's go down now to courtside and rejoin Brent and Billy.
All right, Jim, thank you. We're with Coach Denny Crum and many of the victorious Louisville Cardinals. Denny, congratulations, but it had to scare you to death, the guard rotations that you were forced to in this game.
Well, Brent, anytime you play against great players like Duke has and with the kind of importance it was on this game, it takes a great effort. Both teams played super. I thought our guards did as good as they could do. We didn't score, but they did what we needed them to do in that second half.
Good enough to win a national title. Purvis Ellison, congratulations on being the MVP. You got off to a rocky start in the early moments. Tell me what was going through your mind, how you felt as the game unfolded.
Well, we got great guard play out of Milt Wagner and Jeff Hall, and I think they had to make a decision whether they was going to guard Milt and Jeff tight or they was going to come in on me. And in the first half, they saw the play tight on Milt and Jeff, and that left me one-on-one with my man inside.
I thought the biggest play of the game was your offensive rebound and basket down the stretch.
We was going into a 1-4, and if Jeff or Milt had the ball, we was going to let them go one-on-one. And I looked up and I saw that the shot was falling short. So I got a head start on everybody else and I just tipped it in.
Billy, you have been Mr. Cool throughout this tournament. Now you can break into a big grin. You finally got that national championship.
Yes, it feels good. And I have to say our team came to play today when the chips was down. When we needed to pull it out and play hard, we did it as a team. And we've done it that way all year. And I'm just so glad that we could do it this last game.
Billy, you've got the guard over there.
Well, a little different story. There was never any doubt, Milt, when you went to that foul line. You're shooting over 95% from the line down the clutch, and I know you thought they were going, didn't you?
Yeah, well, I had a bad game the whole game, but whenever I get to that line, I'm very confident when I'm up there. So it was crucial time, and I was ready to put them down for us.
One of the things I noticed that the coach had to give you a lesson, even in your senior, fifth year senior, a little lesson there tonight, huh?
Oh, yeah, I had a hard time trying to stop Johnny Dawkins. He's so quick without the ball and with the ball. I just had my work cut out for me out there tonight.
Denny, you're going to tell me that pass, that was a pass from Hall to Purvis, or was that a shot that came up short?
No, that was a shot. We just cleared for the one-on-one, and the shot came up. Good defense on him, but Purvis is quick, and he took advantage of that in that spot.
Brent?
Denny, how does this one compare with your first one in 1980?
Well, I'm a lot happier, to be honest. Last time, there was seemed to be so much more pressure that it was hard to relax and enjoy it. But I promise you, I will definitely enjoy this one.
I'll tell you a guy that was relaxing, Denny, is your son. He was sound asleep in the second half. You're going to have to work on it.
When he doesn't take a nap, he can't get through these late-night games.
So the victorious Louisville Cardinals, Denny Crum, and the Cardinals have done it. They have come to Dallas, and they have won the national championship. And we will continue from Dallas in a moment. Well, I know I have one thought, and that's the fact that I don't really think there was a loser in this game. Time certainly ran out on the Duke Blue Devils, but what a season those young men had, and I know how empty they must feel right now. Their last dance, and they come up 3 points shy. And Billy, what are your thoughts about this Louisville triumph over Duke?
No, we said at the top of the show, Brent, if they play a 10-game series, it'll probably be 5-5, and I'm even more sure of that now. They're two great basketball teams that played extremely well throughout the course of the year. Their consistency showed tonight.
I think something else has to be said, and that is the fact that Denny Crum belongs up there with the elite. We're always talking about Dean Smith, and we're always talking about Bob Knight. And I think now we got to mention Denny Crum in the same breath with those fellows.
I would agree completely. And I remember Coach Wooden always saying the second one is the hardest one to get. Now he can start talking about a streak because now he joins, as you say, the elite. He's on his way to Springfield Hall of Fame without question. Certainly one of the great coaches in college basketball history.
Billy, it's been a pleasure working with you all season long.
We can't have a bad final game, it doesn't seem.
No way, Billy. Let's go upstairs now to Jim Nance. Jim?
All right, thank you very much, Brent. And so there you have it. Louisville becomes the first team in the 80s to win two championships. And on a night where seven seniors were starting in this ball game, this night definitely belonged to the freshman, Purvis Ellison, with 25 big points. And so another college basketball season has come to an end. We leave you now with the pictures, the emotions, the memories that make this tournament so alive.
Someone to need you too much. Someone to know you too well. Someone to pull you up short and put you through hell and give you support for being alive. Being alive. Make me alive. Make me confused. Mock me with praise. Let me be used. Bury my days. But alone.
Memphis State's Dana Kirk was fired, and his personal finances became the subject of a grand jury scrutiny. Lefty Druzell was forced out at Maryland, this in the aftermath of the Len Bias tragedy. In many ways, it was a turbulent year off the court for the college game, quite often for all the wrong reasons. No story, though, had more impact than the cocaine-related death of Len Bias, 2 days after the Boston Celtics had drafted him number one.
Unfortunately, the season was overwhelmed, I think, by the Len Bias tragedy. It probably transcended the game, and it was the one most important story coming out of last season.
For the National Collegiate Championship Trophy. Sometimes it's not the victor, it's really the survivor. Now that our tournament has expanded to 64 teams, it's somebody that can survive March Madness that finally gets this trophy. Many times it's a case of David and Goliath, and this year we had a little of both. The United States Naval Academy is an unlikely place for a collegiate powerhouse, but this man changed it all. In March, David Robinson was a dominant force in the tournament. His heroics led Navy to the East Regional Final, and this year he's hoping for even more.
When I was in high school, you know, Michael Jordan was in at North Carolina, and Ralph Sampson was in at Virginia, and I just marveled at them and never figured that I'd be on anywhere near their level.
There were other Cinderella stories. Unheralded Cleveland State upset proud Indiana and reached the Sweet 16. Arkansas Little Rock slew mighty Notre Dame. Dale Brown's Louisiana State Tigers emerged from an amazing sequence of down-to-the-wire finishes to make it all the way to the Final Four. Dallas proved to be a gracious host, but LSU's hopes for a miracle title were quickly put to rest. The Louisville Cardinals were at the top of their game. The other semifinal pitted Duke against Kansas, and this crucial basket by Danny Ferry gave Duke the victory.
That kind of counterbalanced the outlawishness of some of the rest of the season. We were all so intrigued with the Dukies, to the point where a lot of cynical journalists, shall I say, it was almost a backlash. These guys are too good to be true. I mean, you know, what do we, you know, Plato isn't playing in the Final Four. Let's get back to, well, what this is really like.
The top-ranked Blue Devils got off to a fast start. Johnny Dawkins ripped off 15 points in the first half. The Duke fans sensed the title as Dawkins' tenacious defense continually harassed the Cardinals. But in the second half, Louisville's defense took over, and freshman Purvis Ellison made all the big plays. And when all was said and done, the Cardinals reigned as national champs for the second time in the 80s. For Denny Crum, the lessons he had learned from the legendary John Wooden at UCLA have served him well.